I believe in violence and freedom.
This is Joe Pyne, and the action starts in just a moment. Robert L. Brock is the founder of the Self-Determination Committee. The committee has determined on a surprising target. Mr. Brock's organization wants to impeach Supreme Court Justice Thurgood Marshall. Mr. Brock calls him, and here I'll have to paraphrase a little bit, a house person. In fact, he continues, Justice Marshall isn't even a citizen of the United States. Why do you call Supreme Court Justice Marshall a house person?
In American history, in chattel slavery, the slave masters developed three kinds of slaves. The slave in the field, the slave in the yard, and the slave in the house. The slave in the house was usually a mulatto offspring and a person that could be trusted. He was ingrained into the society. He was given more privileges, provided he obeyed the master more so than the slave that was working in the field. A user retained more of his culture and his heritage. He was more or less a person that gave in to the master for a privilege, all because of his parentage.
Kind of sold his soul.
Yes, his soul was already sold, but he just sold it himself for a little grain of salt, a little butter on his biscuit.
Now, you have said that Justice Marshall is not even a citizen of the USA. Would you explain that, please?
Well, I am saying that Justice Marshall is a descendant of a slave of African origin. His foreparents were brought here in captivity. They have never come within the Constitution of the United States. They were only put in the Constitution of the United States by a unilateral law called the U.S. Constitution, or the 14th Amendment, or any part of the Constitution. He has never subscribed to the U.S. Constitution. His parents before him, they came out of slavery, never agreed to uphold the Constitution.
Yes, but of course, the justice did swear to uphold the Constitution when he took office.
No, but that's after he had unilaterally been made a citizen by law.
But don't you understand that's the only way to be a citizen by law? I'm a citizen by law. You're a citizen by law.
No, you're a citizen by your own declaration. Then the law applies after your declaration.
Well, I consider myself as declaring myself a citizen is A, as a child and pledging allegiance to the flag, and then entering the Marine Corps at the age of 17.
Well, you
now,
see,
you must have pledged allegiance to the flag as a small boy.
No, I've pledged allegiance. I've even stated I was a U.S. citizen.
You've declared yourself.
No, I haven't declared myself. The declaration that I made as to my citizenship was pursuant to a law forcing me to be a citizen. In other words, let me finish.
But there was no one who ever made you pledge allegiance to the flag, Mr. Brock.
Just a moment. Now, just a moment. all the things that I do in pursuance of the citizenship that I have is based on a law that says I shall perform the duties of a citizen. Now, for instance, if I don't pledge allegiance to the flag, I have to stop at the red light. I have to speak the English language. I have to spend the money according to the U.S. government. I have to do everything according to the rules of the government. Now, here's what I'm saying. The declaration that your parents took out, Mr. Pyne, you inherited the citizenship from that declaration. Citizenship is inheritable. But how can a man coming from chattel slavery inherit
I think I see what you mean. In other words, you're saying that if a man came from Poland,
yes,
and after satisfying the residence requirements,
yes,
he would go down and volunteer to take the citizenship test, and then at a certain time later on, at his own choice, he would be sworn in.
That's right, on his own choice.
Right. But your point is that no African who was originally brought here in slavery was ever in any generation sworn in or even indicated that he wished to be a citizen.
None that I know of. And to rebut this, all you have to do is look at the 14th Amendment will overcome.
Now, let's talk about something else.
All right.
But it comes right back to the same thing.
All right.
If you ever sign an employment contract or a lease for an apartment,
yes,
you will notice somewhere along there that if you do not notify the party of the first or second part, as the case may be,
yes,
within 30 days prior to the expiration of lease or contract,
yes,
the lease or contract is automatically renewed. Therefore, I think we have to assume that unless an African person went down and said, I reject my U.S. citizenship, we have to assume that he wished to be a U.S. citizen.
In other words, you're saying unless he rejected the citizenship that was forced on him within a certain length of time, you would assume that he would be a citizen.
And by now, we have quite a while.
All right, now how much time is necessary before you can reject it?
Well, in the case of most contracts and leases, It's about 30 days, but let's give you 30 years.
No, you have to give me more than 30 years because the states allow, I think the states allow 40 years on that longest statute.
Take 40 years.
All right. Now, but what is the time limit against a government? What would be the time limit against a government?
I don't quite understand that question.
In other words, you're saying 30 days in contracts on homes. You're saying 30 years in states. But now I'm saying how much time is it against a government? A government, see?
Well, if it's a man's lifetime, one would think that somewhere along in a man's lifetime, he would say, I don't wish citizenship here. I wish to be returned to the home of my predecessors, ancestors.
All right, I can give you an answer for that on two grounds. Number one, I'm going to come to the time limit second, but first, to enslave a person and take his wages for 246 years is a crime.
Just a moment. Well, you are assuming, or at least giving us the impression that you're assuming,
yes,
that the man enslaved was so enslaved by the government. That's not true, is it?
Yes, it is true.
It is true?
It is true.
When did the U.S. government ever enslave anybody, per se?
I'll give you that. First of all, the people making up the 13th original colonies on their own act and free will, mm-hmm, revolted and went into revolution against Great Britain. Mm-hmm. They took over the land, the property, and the slaves, these states. These states came together in Philadelphia and by their own voluntary consent drew up the U.S. Constitution. And in the Constitution, Article 1, Section 9, they put a clause that the states could import as many of such persons as they thought fit, and the U.S. government would charge a tax of 10 cents, $10 on each one of these black African slaves. Now, I can give you three or four incidents where the U.S. government used Congress, used the Constitution, and used the Army. Number one, Victor of New Orleans, he came after
Stonewall Jackson.
Yes. Mm-hmm. He authorized troops to go into Florida to kill and bring back slaves that were born free in Florida before coming to the United States.
But my question was, did the United States government, as such,
yes,
ever import from a foreign land, such as Africa, in an official capacity, slaves?
No. Yes, the U.S. government owned slaves. You go into importing. Don't use the word import.
Well,
they owned slaves.
I
they
have to
because part of slavery.
I have to because I can't
speak for a moment. The Constitution authorized slavery.
But I can't speak about the people who were indigenous to this country for a moment. I'm speaking about putting out an order, say, sending the Navy or sending an official arm of the government over to Africa or Jamaica or someplace and getting people in slavery and bringing them back here
as
a government act.
Now, you give me one specific instance of the government importing slaves. The government is a party to slavery in numerous acts.
All right, now let me show you where you may be wrong. There is no law on the federal books against gambling.
Yes.
You understand that?
I understand.
All right. But the government says this, that if you're going to gamble, and we don't want you to, but if you're going to gamble and be a gambler, a professional gambler, you must take out a $50 tax stamp.
Yes.
This will not give you the right to gamble, because if the state of Arkansas or the state of Tennessee or the state of California arrest you for gambling, the federal government won't do anything for you,
mm-hmm,
because we don't see anything for or against gambling any more than the U.S. government says anything for or against murder.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't mean that Uncle Sam is in favor of murder or gambling.
No.
It merely means he chooses not to regulate it.
That's right. Well, the government regulated slavery. The government put out two Fugitive Slave Acts to return slaves. The U.S. government used this In fact, the first treaty that was made by the U.S. government was with the Creek Indians. And in this treaty, the U.S. government signed that the Creek Indian as a nation was to return the slaves to the U.S. government. They used the constitutional authority of treaty authority on the article.
The Indians were to return their slaves.
No, slaves had escaped and went into Creek territory, or the Creek Nation.
Oh, I see.
And the
Indians were to give up the protection
they made
were
the first treaty of the United States was that the Creeks were to give up these slaves. The United States government negotiated on behalf of slaveholders. Wait just a moment.
Well, we're coming back to you right after these words. Mr. Brock, do you regard yourself as still a slave?
I regard myself as a captive and in several forms of slavery.
All right.
As I do all
now,
slaves.
Now, a captive, the term captive would imply that you're being held someplace against your will.
Against my will, all right then.
All right. Who is holding you in the United States against your will?
The United States government and his slaveholding class of white citizens is holding me subject to the power, authority, and criminal jurisdiction of the U.S. government to obey its laws.
But the day you leave the jurisdiction of this country, the day you renounce the citizenship you claim you don't have, you are no longer subject to the laws of this nation.
The day I renounce that.
Yes,
you see,
sir.
But on what basis can I base a renunciation? I have to base a renunciation on a previous law of
then
acceptance.
If you feel you have nothing to renounce, all you need do is leave.
No.
And seek citizenship in some other country. Is that true?
No, it don't work that easy.
Why
you don't
is that?
Just leave.
Who's holding you?
No, it's just like...
How much money do you have in the bank?
Well, that's all right, but let's get on back to
you
this
You have
now.
Enough money
let's
to pay for an airplane
this.
Ticket to someplace
in the
world?
No, it don't work that way.
Huh?
It don't work that
Why
way.
Why not?
That I have enough money to just leave the United States.
Why not?
No, see? In fact, the United States wouldn't let 10,000 blacks or 5,000 blacks or 500 blacks leave at once in the first place.
Show me the law that says
see?
They won't.
Well, the law, I don't have to show you no law that allowed them to come in the first place.
But you know there's no law preventing anybody who is not a felon, not a convicted felon, from leaving. A citizenship requires that you be given a passport to any country where we have diplomatic recognition.
Yeah, but you didn't have a passport to come in the first place.
Well, that doesn't matter about now, because you can get a passport to get out.
No, the now goes on now, then goes on now.
And I want to tell you
it's
something.
It's a continuation.
I want to tell you something.
Never ended.
Now get this.
Yes.
Yes, there is. There is no such thing as perpetual motion, Mr. Block.
Let's hear this.
And Mr. Block, and get this. The very fact that you can be issued a passport with the eagle on it, the U.S. passport, will prove to any nation in the world, as well as this one, that you are a U.S. citizen.
No, it will prove that the United States government makes a statement that I'm a U.S. citizen pursuant to my slave status.
And if you
can call a slave a citizen anytime you want.
Will it say slave on your passport?
It'll say citizen on there.
Right.
What's that got to do with the actual facts? You can call a slave a citizen?
Well, if you take that passport to Morocco,
yeah.
or if you take it to France,
yeah.
how will they regard you?
They will regard me as a U.S. citizen.
They're not under any orders from the U.S. government, are they?
No more than according to the treaty.
Then why do they recognize you as a U.S. citizen? Because you don't get a passport unless you are one.
No, just the moment. You can give a slave a passport. Now, let's not get into quibble about the words. Now, let's get on back
Since
to the law.
Since when do slaves need passports?
See, I have cases on that, too.
I want to get on to something else anyway.
No, that's all right. Let me
I think
prove
you're
the time.
Hung up.
Let me prove the time limit.
Go on.
You mentioned a while ago about the statute of limitation if a man stays here. what is the statute of limitation before a slave descendant can complain about his rights of being forced into a government? You see?
Suppose then that I get the ear of a U.S. senator tomorrow.
Yes.
And within a year, I get a law passed that says the statute of limitations is 20 years.
Yes.
Now, where are you?
Would
that make you stop your impeachment proceedings against Thurgood Marshall?
Any law that the U.S. government should make pursuant to the statute of limitation on my rights. It's not legal because I never adopted the law to be binding by the statute.
So then you take a case to the Supreme Court. They say it is legal. What do you do then?
Well, that brings on revolution and rebellion.
Oh, in other words, when the law is finally ratified by the joint houses and approved legally by the Supreme Court, you still say you won't accept it. You'll revolt.
Well, I never accepted it in the first place.
Well... What is your purpose in staying in the United States?
My purpose in staying... You act as if I'm staying here because I agreed to be here. I am here because of the force of arms of the U.S. government.
If you have enough money in the bank to buy one ticket away, and you are here,
I didn't come here by any money. In fact,
that?
I made money since I've been here.
Yeah.
I didn't come here.
Right.
I didn't pay my way here.
No. You misunderstand me.
I don't misunderstand
If you me. Have enough money to buy your way out of the country, and I'm sure you do, then every day you stay here is an admission. That this is where you want to be.
No, it's not. Why is it admission when from 1619, according to the U.S. records, until the present day, until, say, chattel slavery was over?
Well, if a man back in the old days was a slave...
The sun still shines as it did then.
...making about $5 a week and food for his family, he was a sharecropper...
No, I'm talking about the condition of slavery in the old days.
Wait a minute, this man couldn't think about buying a ticket out of this country.
It's not...
But you can. You're sitting there in your Brooks Brothers suit, and you could buy your way out.
No.
And you don't buy your way out. Why?
It don't go according to buying your way out, because I didn't buy my way in, and I didn't have a ticket to come in. In the old days, in the new days... In the young days, and the sun still shines the same. You can't
Are you directly descended from a slave?
Well,
you aren't.
I've been told that I was a descendant of a slave.
But you can't prove that, can you?
I can prove that I was born from a mother and father that's living now.
Sure, but they were born here.
They were born here. All the chattel slaves that I know of were born here.
Where did their mothers and fathers come from?
In the United States.
And where did their mothers and fathers come from?
In the United States.
Yeah, and where did their mothers and fathers come from?
Then, chattel slavery. Chattel slavery.
How do you know?
How do I know?
Can you prove it? You have documents to prove it.
All right, now here, just a moment. Now, all right, and you got your foot in the news. When you said, do I have documents? The U.S. government refused to accept proof from any chattel slave because he was considered not to be a human being. I do not have to prove it. The U.S. government must prove and have the documents because I was denied the right to prove my heritage before 1865 when the 13th Amendment was passed.
When the
I do
US
not have
government,
to prove where my great forefathers come from.
Now, wait a minute. If I, for example, get old enough to collect Social Security, the burden of proof is on me to prove, A, I'm a native-born citizen, and B, I am eligible based on payments for Social Security.
Yes.
So the burden of proof is on me to prove I'm a citizen.
Yes.
If I want to get a passport, I've got to take my birth certificate down and prove that. Why do you think you shouldn't have to prove that you're descended from a slave?
I'll tell you why. Because I do not have a declaration anywhere on the immigration record or anywhere in Washington, D.C. from my foreparents proving citizenship. I cannot prove
you have a birth certificate, Mr. Brock?
Birth certificates.
Do you have one? Do you have one?
Now, birth certificates is not the same as birth certificate. You're going to be born when the time comes, 9 or 7 or 10 or 12 months. You're going to be born. What's that prove because you got a birth certificate? That's all a slave have is a birth certificate.
It proves where you were born.
No, just a moment. Now, just a moment. No, no. You see, the government didn't issue birth certificates to slaves.
No, but they counted them in the census.
They counted them in the census as chattels. For tax purposes. And the ones that didn't have tax on them, they didn't count them.
But the fact is that their children, the slaves' children who were born here, were born as U.S. citizens.
The parents never took it out.
You know, my parents never took it out either. You don't take citizenship out.
You mean somebody along your line declared themselves?
If you were from Czechoslovakia and your wife was from Greenland and you had a child here.
Yep.
By the mere fact that child is born here, that child is a citizen, you have nothing to do with it. We'll be back to you, sir, after these words. You made a statement, I believe in violence as a solution.
I believe this. When I say violence as a solution, I said that this is what I mean when I say violence. I mean that the United States government and its slaveholding class of white citizens are holding the descendants of slaves of African origin in a state of captivity and enslavement and subjugation. And if violence is necessary to obtain freedom from this, I agree that violence should be used.
All right, then what kind of freedom do you want with your violence?
Well, I didn't say with violence.
Freedom to be more violent?
I didn't say freedom to be more violent.
Well, what kind of freedom do you want? Put a man
now,
of your race on the Supreme Court bench. In fact, a white man put him on that bench.
Well, sure, a white man put the black man in the field to pick cotton for 246 years, didn't give him any pay. So what's that about a white man? That proves more of his enslavement.
No, I think it proves a little bit of enlightenment.
No, it doesn't prove it. It proves that the time has come with the Afro-Asian nations pushing the Western people that you've got to show a front. That's what it proves. You didn't put the man there because you got an enlightenment. You put him there because you're running.
All right. Let's say that you are violent and you are successful in your
violence. You're not
violent
when you're a slave. A slave cannot be violent.
Well, you say you approve of violence.
It all depends on the term.
I'll read your words again. I believe in violence as a solution.
No, if somebody is withholding me against my will, and I should defend myself with all the force I can, that's not violence.
Well, then why don't I see handcuffs on you? Why don't I see you chained to the wall? There's nobody stopping you from walking down the passport bureau and get yourself a ticket for Timbuktu.
You can be in jail, and you can be under the jurisdiction of a government, whether you're in a state, in a county, or locked in a closed cell.
Now, I want to tell you something.
Yes.
If I go to Ghana tomorrow, as long as I'm in Ghana, even though I'm not a citizen, I have to abide by the laws of Ghana.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Is that true?
That's right.
Then whether or not you're a citizen, even if you were a visitor from some other place,
as
long as you're here, you abide by the rules of this country, which, by the way, are pretty great because they guarantee everybody, whether he's a citizen or not, due process.
You abide by law and order. During chattel form of slavery, the slaves abided by law and order. They've abided by law and order up to this date.
I'm going to come back to my original question to you.
All right, then.
Let's say that this violence that you advocate comes about.
Violence. Now, there you go.
I believe in violence
and
as
freedom.
A solution.
No, I said I believe in violence and freedom.
No, you didn't say that.
Well, let's play the tape back. play the
I've
tape back.
I've got your exact quote, sir. I'll read it all the way.
Read what I have here, then you'll be able to read
it.
Well,
I'm going to read your exact quote. This is what you told my office.
All right.
I believe in violence as a solution. It shows the black people are at last waking up. It is a good sign. The people in Watts were justified in rebelling. They were fighting for their freedom, unquote. That is your total statement?
Yes.
Period. All right. Now, let's suppose that you get this violence over with and you get what you want. What do you want?
What do I want? Whatever I want, I shouldn't have to tell you what I want, because if I tell you what I want, I am admitting slavery to you.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am.
How do you figure
You're asking me what do I want.
I absolve you. I free you. In case you feel that you might be my slave,
yeah,
I free you.
Well.
Now, what is it you want? Do you know what you want? I don't think you do.
That's all right. I do know this, that self-determination.
Why don't you answer the question?
I do know
you're
that.
You're afraid of it, aren't you?
Not afraid of what?
My question.
Oh, you have to push the question to me. I know what I want.
What is it you want?
I know what I don't have. I don't have my freedom self-determination.
All right. Tell me how you can get that freedom. What would it be when you got it?
No, self-determination is what I desire, what every man should have.
Self-determination.
Self-determination or freedom.
All right. Now, do I have a bigger vote than you today?
You have the control of the vote.
That's because I outnumber you.
I don't mean you have the
You're going to have to get a lot more Negroes going for you to change that.
No. You can get the blacks in this country, 1,000 blacks and 10 whites, to vote in a precinct. And the whites will still control the votes overall.
Then how do you account for the man who's going to be the first Negro mayor of a giant Midwestern city? How do you account for a senator from Massachusetts, where in all these places the Negroes are outnumbered?
See, well, I tell you what you do. He's one of the lesser dogs. You can always take take a slave and put him a mayor. You can put him a senator. You can put him a lawyer, a judge. You can put him anywhere where it's convenient for you. And because the white people vote for a black man to be mayor, they still control the voting process. They still control the government.
You know what I'm going to do?
Well,
I'm going to bring a legal action against these African tribes that sold you people to us, because they sold us a package that is causing us a great deal of trouble on welfare. They sold us a package that contributes largely to our crime rate in the majority. They sold us a package that fills the jails. They sold us a package that disrupts our economy in the cities. And I don't think we got what we paid for.
All right,
we
now let me tell you this about three of
Africans.
Those things you said. No. On the crime rate. On the crime rate, immediately after chattel slavery was over, the white people in the southern states needed somebody to go to work. They were a little too lazy to go to work after the Civil War was over. So what they did, they took the 13th Amendment, where it says no one shall be enslaved unless convicted for a crime. They imprisoned 46,000 blacks within 2 years after chattel slavery was over, so they could get around the 13th Amendment, so they could put them in workhouses, to put them back on the plantation.
I noticed that.
That's the high crime rate.
We run out of time.
That's one.
We run out of time.
On the welfare. Welfare.
Yeah, hurry up.
Welfare is a way that the U.S. government supports their slaves to keep them on hand for war purposes. The welfare is to the benefit of the U.S. government and not to the benefit of the blacks. The U.S. government is escaping from their responsibility.
Well, how about
by
the
so
money?
Doing this.
How about the money those Africans owe us for selling you people to us in the first place?
I don't know if any Africans ever. I know if you're going
all
the way over
there,
Captain.
The sole Africans.
No, there's no history to that effect.
All right, I'll tell you what.
See?
We run out of time.
Yeah.
You report to my tobacco fields in the morning.
Oh, well.
Our guest has been R.L. Brock.
Yeah.
This is Joe Pyne.
Yeah.
And I'll be back following station identification. I ran you 2 minutes over.